radiation. Because the radiation can be polarized, we have this other leverage, and here it's represented by these lines. The Planck satellite studied essentially extensively and with high precision these anisotropies, and also provided very good information regarding the polarization of the cosmic microwave background. In order to put things a little bit into context, I need to tell you something about what we believe is the evolution of the universe. We now all believe in the theory of the Big Bang. So as we sit here, we look at galaxies and clusters of galaxies around us, but we know that the galaxies are moving away from each other, and we believe now in the Big Bang theory, according to which going back in time, the universe was denser and hotter. So as you go back, you may imagine that all the matter was interacting, and there were no galaxies formed and so on, and the radiation was also interacting with the matter. The moment in which this ceased to happen goes under the name of the last scattering surface. From that point on, the radiation kind of reached us directly without interacting much with the matter, and the matter could grow gravitationally. So in fact, the structure could form more efficiently. So you can, first of all, you can appreciate how the anisotropies that we see around us are essentially a more recent mirror of what was going on back then, which is encoded instead in the cosmic microwave background radiation. So these two types of anisotropies that we see should convey the same kind of cosmological information. The other aspect is that there is a fundamental question: why are there these anisotropies? And the current theory believes that these anisotropies are there because of what happened in the very beginning of time, the universe went through a period of exponential expansion that goes under the name of inflation. The mechanics of the inflationary period predicts that there should be this kind of anisotropies. And it also predicts a little bit how they should look like. So indeed, we would like to try to use the observations that we have to infer something about this very initial time. Another moment that is sketched here, which is also important in the history of the universe, and I'm going to tell you about, is this period that is called of reionization. Essentially, what happens here is that hydrogen becomes neutral. And when hydrogen becomes neutral, the photon cannot interact with the hydrogen atom very efficiently, and that's why the universe becomes transparent. But when the first stars and quasars and so on light up, they partially reionize the universe, and so there are a little bit more free electrons around. And so some of these CMB photons interacting with this free electron leave a particular signature. This signature is visible in the polarization of the cosmic microwave background, and it's one of the aspects that I will touch upon. So, because we get some information from the CMB. Only one other thing I want to mention about this plot is that you understand that, of course, since these anisotropies mirror this one at a much earlier time, they are much smaller in amplitude, because later on, perturbation can grow, and so anisotropies can become bigger. So in a sense, while they are difficult to observe because they are small, they are very easy to interpret, because every equation you have that describes your system, you can easily linearize it. So in these observations are more difficult to make, however, they are much more easy to interpret. So once we got to the observation, in a sense, that's why we kind of strongly believe in the results that we get from the cosmic microwave background, rather than the ones that involve complicated galaxy physics. I mean, this is a little bit of a partisan part of the talk, but okay, so let's go through the history a little bit quickly. As I was telling you, when was the the cosmic microwave background presence even conceived, since we don't see it so easily. This happened when we discovered that these nebulae out there that we were seeing on the sky were actually moving away from us in 1930 or so, right after theorists started to come up with potential models for this to happen. One of these models was the model of the Big Bang, which predicted that if you then squeeze all the matter back in time, there should have been also some radiation that was interacting intensively with the matter. And so this relic radiation should still be there. They made a prediction that it should be at around 5 Kelvin. And this prediction seemed also to explain pretty well what one was seeing in terms of abundances of light elements in stars. So there were some support for it, but there was no practical confirmation. Then come these two guys, Penzias and Wilson, who were actually employee of Bell Labs, and they had built this antenna for whatever reason they needed it, I don't remember, in the radio band, one frequency essentially, or one band in frequency, and they had this noise that they couldn't actually get rid of, and they were thinking of airplane, they were thinking of birds releasing stuff while they were flying above the antenna, they were thinking of everything, they couldn't actually find a reason why. And so they ended up, almost by chance, chatting with their Princeton colleagues who told them that the MIT people or themselves, I don't remember, were building an instrument to measure this predicted cosmic microwave background radiation. And so they did 2 plus 2, and they understood that this thing they couldn't get rid of, because it was actually there and everywhere. And this way, they published a paper with the first detection of the cosmic microwave background radiation, and then they got the first Nobel Prize. And so then what happened? Of course, they only measured one frequency, right? If this was indeed the radiation, the cosmic microwave background radiation, this was supposed to be in thermal equilibrium with all the rest of the matter early on. So it should have a black body spectrum. And this confirmation came with the first satellite that was launched to study specifically the cosmic microwave background. This satellite is named COBE. It had 2 instruments on it, COBE FIRAS, that was precisely measuring the spectrum. And you can see these are the error bars, right? So here you don't even see the error bars because they are too tiny. But so FIRAS measured the cosmic microwave background radiation on various different frequencies and confirmed that it's actually a black body. And then the other thing that it did is that it measured the temperature in various locations on the sky. And this is what it found. So this, I would argue, is the most boring picture in all history of astronomy. I have a second best candidate later on in my plots. So this is the temperature of the cosmic microwave background radiation all over the sky. On average, is 2.72 Kelvin, okay? In order to see something better, you've got to take away the average. And what you're left with is this kind of dipolar structure at the level of the millikelvin, okay? This is interpreted as our motion with respect to the cosmic microwave background rest frame. And if you can stay awake until the last slide, I will show you that my student is putting out a paper that suggests how to use these distortions of the power spectrum to disentangle our motion from the, with respect to the cosmic microwave background radiation, and distinguish that from an intrinsic dipole that could be there for a primordial reason, from inflation or whatever. Anyhow, that's the last slide, so let's go on. So once you think you have understood this, then you take away dipole from this map, and what you find is this other map that has structure of the order of the microkelvin. Okay? Now, this one is actually our galaxy, so we understand it pretty well. So that's the plane of our galaxy that is emitting at this, this frequency, and you cannot avoid it. These other blobs here are the anisotropies that we expected to see there if indeed the cosmic microwave background radiation was interacting with matter back back in time. Okay, so essentially COBE did two very important discoveries. First, it confirmed that the power spectrum, the frequency spectrum of the cosmic microwave background radiation is a Planck spectrum, so it means that it was a thermal type of radiation. And second, it discovered and confirmed the existence of these anisotropies. As I told you, these anisotropies are difficult to observe because they are tiny, but if you know that they are there, they're very easy to interpret. So this immediately triggered. So actually, this came a little bit later. So these two guys got also the Nobel Prize for their satellite, right? But much later, in about 2003, I believe, for their discovery. So of course, their work triggered immediately. So this was about 1994, triggered the planning of the future mission. Now, in order to continue, you have to bear with me and understand a little bit how we actually describe things, because one could simply say, well, you take a map and you interpret the map, sure, but that's not the most convenient way to actually interpret these data. The reason being that if you want to make a high-resolution experiment, an experiment that maps these anisotropies better, like these are not very well resolved, like these blobs, so they are the beam of this experiment was about 7 degrees. If you want to have a higher resolution experiment that maps these blobs better, you also have to bear with the fact that you've got a map with like a million pixels or so. And then if you want to invert the map with a million pixels to do data analysis, that's a little bit tricky. So you want to try to get lighter, and you can do it because theory supports you. So the reason is that essentially all the information that there is in this map can be encoded simply in a variance over a certain scale. This because we believe that these anisotropies are put there by inflation, and inflation predicts that these anisotropies should be Gaussian in nature. So if you have a Gaussian, you just need one number to describe it. The variance, right? So you don't need the whole distribution, every single point. You just need the variance, you are done. So this is what we actually do. We just keep track of the variance of that signal at various scale. So what you see cosmologists talk about is what we call the CL, the power spectrum. And simply what it means is that you take the temperature anisotropy and you develop it on spherical harmonics, so the same functions that you use to solve, I don't know, scattering problems in quantum mechanics or something like that, right? Now, if you remember spherical harmonics, the L value is connected with the length of the typical structure on the sky. So L equal to 2 is a quadrupole. You see there are two red blobs and two blue blobs. If you increase the value of L, you can describe finer and finer structures. Okay, so somewhat the L value is inverse to the angle that you can actually, you're observing on the sky. But you say, well, there is no advantages if you take all the coefficients of the spherical harmonics. You're right. So what is relevant here is that, in fact, you don't care about the actual physical orientation. You just care about the amplitude of the signal on a given scale. You don't care if your wave is put like that or put like that, because we believe that the universe is isotropic and we just live in a random realization of it. So you sum out the M coefficient and you retrieve only the power spectrum that depends on one variable L. This for satellites like Planck reduce your problem from having to deal with a million pixels to having to deal with like 3,000 numbers, which is much more handy, I would say, right? So that's why when you talk with cosmologists, very often they show you plots like this. This is the expected power spectrum of the anisotropies. And of course, as you go to higher L, you go to smaller scale. And so this tells you the same thing, right? So if you have a large structure, you have a peak at low L. If you have a finer and finer structure, then it moves over to higher L. Now, so that goes a little bit of a history. This was the situation like before the year 2000 or so. So these were the COBE results, the one I showed you, these blue dots. And then right after, people started to try to launch balloons or make ground-based experiments. And there was like a forest of experiments that were kind of compatible one with each other, but there was no clear trend. If you weren't in any of those collaborations, so you actually weren't you know, with your head deeply thinking about that particular instrument, you could bin all those in a clever way and show that, in fact, you could already see the peak that you expected from the theory. Then right after, the second satellite, CMB satellite, came about, and look at the precision with which it mapped the power spectrum. So COBE is down here. You see at most it measured up to L equal 20, which in this plot is about here, okay? And WMAP, which is the second satellite, arrived to L equal 500 or so, and also it had some polarization capability. So this is how fast this field has evolved. You can already imagine. So this is a little bit of a summary of the three experiments, right? When they were launched, Planck was launched later. It was planned more or less at the same time, but it was meant to do things in a better way under several points of view, so it took longer to prepare. And in which are the improvements that Planck had over WMAP? One is spatial resolution, the details on which it could resolve, and therefore the maximum L value it could map. The frequency coverage, so how many frequencies were actually mapped. The pictures that you saw at the very first introductory slide were the nine maps at the various frequencies as observed by Planck. And then polarization capabilities and noise level. The two of those can kind of go hand in hand, and I will explain you why. There is not much sense in having polarization capability if you don't have a high sensitivity. So these are the improvements like in a visual way. So COBE was a little bit broad, right? WMAP got better details. Planck has much better details, except that your eye can only resolve about, you know, 20 arc seconds, so you don't see much of a difference between these two. Well, but when you see the power, you will see the power spectrum. You will see a power spectrum for Planck that goes out to L, you know, 2500 rather than 500. Okay. So the second capability is the capability to resolve polarization. So if you have waves that, you know, move in this direction and preferentially oscillate like that, you can measure only the ones that are polarized in a given direction, and that can give you some extra information. Because we know that the scattering processes that went on in the very early universe produced some level of polarization, we want to study that so that we can have another leverage on our observable, okay? The important part is that the polarization signal is way weaker than the total intensity signal. Therefore, there is no point in having an instrument that can measure polarization if you don't reduce the noise level by a lot, okay? So that in that sense, Planck is doing much better than WMAP. Another thing that can be useful later on is the understanding of which type of polarization you can study. When I was an undergraduate, I was taught Stock parameters, right? And indeed, they are still good, so it's worth knowing them. But the cosmologists normally use this decomposition in E and B modes, which essentially mirror the symmetry properties of your field. So if you have an overdensity, you expect the polarization around that point to be of this structure or this structure, so just like an E field for electromagnetism. And instead, there are processes in the early universe that can produce gravitational waves, and the gravitational waves can produce this structure that has a curl. So this is why we kind of distinguish the two. So this particular type of polarization is what people are after now, like crazy, because if we detect them, then we have a new window on inflation and on the early universe, and we can say something very significant regarding the physics of the very early universe that we cannot investigate otherwise. I will argue that we cannot understand this very well if we don't understand very well the astrophysics of our galaxy at the same time. These are simulations of what would be an E pattern versus a B pattern on the sky. Okay, so third big improvement that Planck had, this is actually a slide that only has WMAP results because Planck would be too long. So we want to study the cosmic microwave background, but unfortunately in between us and the cosmic microwave background, there is a lot of stuff, okay? There is our galaxy with more than one type of emission. There are electrons that emit through synchrotron radiation. Then there is some dust that emits some other ways. And also there are here, they're not very visible because they are tiny in here. You can see maybe a little spot there. There are extragalactic objects. There are radio galaxies, clusters of galaxies, and so on. So all this gets added up to your individual maps so that this is what you observe at various frequencies. So before interpreting your data, you need to play an inversion game. You have to take your observation and then try to infer from your various observations at various frequencies what these guys are so that you can clean up your sky, your CMB sky. You understand very well that the more frequencies you have, the better leverage you have in doing such an exercise, right? And it's actually pretty important. So once you have done that, so in this sense, Planck that had frequencies coverage from 30 gigahertz to 150 did better than WMAP. Once you imagine you have done all your effort, and then you finally have your CMB map, so what do you do with it? Well, you want to try to infer cosmology from it, which means you want to try to measure accurately what's the expansion velocity of our universe that goes under the name of the Hubble constant. And then you want to understand whether we lived in a flat space or if it's curved. You want to understand which kind of energy densities there are in our universe. You know, how much, if we do need dark energy, if yes, how much dark energy, if there is matter, good, but how is it split between baryons and dark matter, for example? They behave differently with respect to the radiation, right? You want to try to infer the history of reionization, how the first objects lightened up. Then maybe you're even more want to be more precise. Well, you can say, can I say something about the nature of dark matter? Not all the dark matter behave the same way, especially if you go back in time toward earlier and earlier period. Then, on top of that, you should remember that all these perturbations were originated from inflation initially. So if you study those, you can infer properties of inflation. So you quickly see that you have a lot of data. You have this million pixels, but then you also want to fit like 10 parameters to it, right? So it's a tricky game. Yes? Well, so the copy normalization, it's actually among this, right? Because inflation will tell you various properties of those initial anisotropies, including how big they are. But in order to answer your question, so COBE, let's go back to here. COBE measured these points, right? So it measured an overall normalization that is of the order of the 30 micro K in CL. However, this yellow band down here represents what we call cosmic variance. So the fact that we live in one single realization of the universe. So COBE had some kind of big uncertainty in it. Once you get to WMAP, you understand that the normalization issue means trying to fit all those data together, right? So it's one of the parameters that goes into this in this whole picture. Okay, so instead of telling you, like I had an example on how geometry works, so I'm telling you what's the job of people like me. So you are then, somebody hopefully gives you a map, okay, and you see these maps have kind of similar features here, there, there, but you also see that there are differences. This has less blue spots than this one or that one. So you're given those maps and you actually have to deliver parameters, right? So what you do is you measure the power spectra from these maps. So far so good, we know spherical harmonics. And from that, you try to fit those power spectra with the theoretical power spectra that are derived considering a certain number of parameters. So you see, it's our life is actually much easier than the ones of the experimentalist. Oops. I wanted to try to. Oh yeah. All right. Okay. I forgot about that. I wanted to impress you, show you that it's so easy that you can actually do it yourself. In fact, the WMAP people had put up a website where you can vary parameters, and that will vary it will show you the map corresponding to those parameters, and it shows you how well you are matching the actual observations or not. So you can tweak yourself the parameters in order to get the correct cosmology. Okay, so now it's so easy that it's also on the web, so I'm practically out of business. So, unfortunately, I forgot that I needed the internet. All right, so these are the actual results. Okay, so this is the Planck map, the actual reconstructed map with some massaging on it, because as you can see, the galaxy has disappeared. And here it has been reconstructed with the same kind of statistical observations that you see in other areas over here. But the rest, it's not fake, it's true. So it's 5 arc minute map. And this is the power spectrum that has been derived. You can see that you don't even can see error bars up to 2500. Well, I remind you, WMAP only arrived to 500 or so, okay. On top of that, so this is in my quotes is the second most boring figure in the whole astronomy history. These are the polarization maps. In order to make them more boring, they actually, before publishing them, they subtracted the large scale. So if there were some kind of general modulation, it disappeared. So it literally looked like noise, right? But anyhow, so these are the polarization C and B maps, but they are of fundamental importance because Planck actually really made this the very, very first good measurement. WMAP could only detect the cross correlation between the E type of polarization and the temperature. Planck primarily sees, of course, the E polarization, which is the one that is the most intense, but these are actually polarization maps. So, just for comparison, so this is the temperature TE cross spectra for WMAP that again arrived at 400, you see this little thing wiggle over here, and this is the same thing for Planck. So 500 is here, so WMAP got like this little wiggle and actually screwed up big times at this point up here, but let's forget about that. You see, you know, here you get, I don't know, 3, 4, 5, 6 peaks or something, right? This is just for the cross correlation. On top of that, this is what Planck detected, also the EE polarization. So just the E polarization without temperature, which WMAP couldn't get. In the end, essentially, this is, you know, Planck derived these three spectra with a super high precision on all the various peaks up to, you know, 5 or 6, 7 peaks, whatever it is. So to make a long story short, those are the primary parameters that have been constrained. So this would be, for example, the baryonic matter. This is the cold dark matter. This is the reionization parameter, which I'm going to tell you about. This is the value of H naught, and as you can see, there is a, I don't know, a 10% or 1% uncertainty or something like that. So when I was starting as a graduate student or at the, my last year of undergrad, I remember sitting there in talks where they were presenting me with measurement of H naught that there could be either 50 or 100. So there was a 100% uncertainty on that value, right? So so this is like the 1%. And one current very important debate that is in place is, in fact, there are some measurements that are challenging this result. There are people that measure supernovae, prominent people, other Nobel Prizes, for example, that they, by measuring supernovae, they made an estimate of this H naught, and they find a slightly higher value, which is incompatible with this one at about, you know, 3 sigma level in their measurement. So, however, you know, typically the CMB now is kind of the golden standard because it looks so good, right? It gave such a wonderful results. So there is these other scientists are trying to find somebody in the CMB community that actually goes after to determine what the discrepancy is, if there is some space for physics that has not been considered, because you have to understand that these results rely on our assumptions of the model, of the underlying model. If there is something that we are missing in the underlying model, of course some of these parameters are going to be not precise, right? So this is an ongoing debate, but as you can see, however, the current level of the data is incredible, it's fantastic. So other an example of other parameters that are determined very well is this parameter FNL. It tells you how much these anisotropies are actually non-Gaussian. So to what extent you can only describe them with a power spectrum or if you need something else. So it was unbelievable, like up until WMAP, the results on this parameter were 200 or something, right? So incredible advances in every respect. I'm just going through some of those, and then so that I can actually tell you a little bit about what I have done or I work on. So one aspect is reionization. So these results, the two results that I'm talking about, are intimately connected with the measurement of polarization. So they came out with the latest release for Planck, and they heavily depend on the polarization mapping and the polarization measurement. One of these is the measurement of the optical depth that encodes the reionization of the universe. So, as I said, right after the last scattering, the universe becomes neutral, and photons typically pass through. But as structures start to form, you have stars and galaxies, newborn galaxies and quasars that tends to ionize bubbles around. And at some point, everything becomes reionized again. And many astrophysicists would love to know how this happened. It's also important that the amplitude of the fluctuation match with our understanding of structure formation. So the study of this period is important also in that respect. And normally, how do you study this? You look at distant quasars, you look at the spectra of this distant quasar in order to infer how much ionized fraction there is or there is not. These are, you know, first you've got to have a quasar, and then at most you get a quasar at redshift 7, so at a certain distance from us. So you can't really go much further if the quasar hadn't formed, right? So there are some limitations in those measurements. The CMB gives you an integrated value of the ionization fraction, so it's not a very good method to describe precisely the reionization history, but it can tell you like a bulk value of when it actually started, okay? And this is encoded in this EE power spectrum. Let's see if we can go back. This is the thing that they got slightly wrong over here. They actually overestimated this point. But So this is the TE, and then there is the EE, or they cut out very conveniently the very low multiples. So the ones that are not shown here are the ones from which you get reionization. So the results, with respect to what had been found before, you have to understand that in order to derive this result, you need large-scale measurement of the polarization. So you need a satellite, right? So this is the state of the art for the next, whenever NASA decides to send next satellite, which is not even in the deck at the moment. So that's gonna last forever. So that essentially what Planck showed is that reionization occurred later than what WMAP had shown. And this is better because our understanding of structure formation would have had some problems in forming structure back at the time where that map was inferring structure should be there to reionize the universe. So this is already a little bit of problem solved. The other result that made a lot of noise, if you want, I'm sure you've heard about it, is this result regarding gravitational waves. Gravitational waves are ripples that can be put there. So if you only have scalar perturbation, they are completely symmetric and they only produce E-mode type of polarization. But if you have gravitational wave, these are perturbation of the matrix, and they can produce B type of polarization. You can stretch space in this direction and in this direction while the wave goes over in this other direction, and you can produce this curl pattern. Okay. Now, the problem is that these tensor modes, they have this distinct feature of the B pattern. However, you see this B pattern is way below the typical temperature anisotropy that you expect. And indeed, the actual amplitude of this value could be much lower than that. Here it's exaggerated with the tensor to scalar ratio of 1. And it could be much lower. It could even be 0. So it depends from the type of inflationary process that actually occurred. So at the moment, we are trying to put upper limits on this value. However, so this is what I just told you, that inflationary predicts this mode, and they give us a direct window on the early universe. So what happened a couple of years ago, I don't know if you remember, there was this paper put out by the BICEP team. The BICEP is a CMB experiment that runs at the South Pole, actually led by Caltech. It was built by the guys on the floor below me when I was a research fellow at Caltech. And so they put out this result, impressive result on BB polarization, while everybody else had, you know, these higher upper limits. And so this part of the results, they could interpret through gravitational lensing effect of the cosmic microwave background. That can also produce a B mode, but you expect lensing to have this kind of effect. So it shouldn't be very important on large scale. However, they had these other points over here that could not be explained with lensing. And so they said this must be gravitational waves with this tensor to scalar ratio of 0.2. And if you read the abstract, they say that R equal to 0 was excluded at 7 sigma or something like that, right? So this was another potential Nobel Prize kind of discovery. However, they only had, BICEP only had one frequency or two, I don't know, I think it's one frequency to look at. So CMB experimentalists have been very lucky in their work, right? So they had discovered this little spot on the sky where apparently there was little dust from our galaxy. So they already made fantastic results, and they had fantastic results by looking at this spot in temperature. So they said, okay, let's do the same in polarization. However, not always temperature and polarization track each other, right? So they put these results, but they only had one frequency. That means they couldn't really separate the various components, right? So later on, right after Planck delivered their map, about 6 months later or so, and this is what they have found. They did like a joint analysis, and what they found is essentially that there is a Oh yeah, so this is the Lenzing mode. What am I saying? So they found simply an upper limit on this tensor to scalar ratio of 0.12, and they ruled out the detection. So what was the mystery behind it? In reality, what was happening is that there was some leftover polarization in this area of the sky that from the dust in our own galaxy, and nobody could guess it because there were no actual very good measurement of the polarization of our galaxy. Only an experiment like Planck that had several frequency covered in temperature and polarization, a whole routine to actually separate these all components, could in fact make a proper data analysis in that area, right? So this is an example in which there is an interest on some data that come from two very different communities, in a sense. So I'll leave you here. So this is something on which the current the people who want to plan future experiments really focus on how much you can push down this limit, since now we are not sensitivity limited, we are clearly foreground limited, right? So it's not that you make you observe more this area of the sky and you get a better result, or you build a better instrument and you improve your sensitivity and you get a better result. You have to figure out how to take away the stuff that is in between you and the cosmic microwave background. Now, if you bear with me, I was actually pretty good in time. So I will tell you a little bit about what I worked on since I'm here. More directly, of course, I participated in general to many of these results, but more directly, I work on galaxy cluster. So I wanted just to show you the maps, just to show you that. So these are the foreground maps in polarization of our galaxy. This is another result that came out from Planck out of this component separation technique. So these were unprecedented, right? These things never existed when we were actually planning the experiment. And you can imagine that this is very interesting for anybody doing galactic astronomy, because of the structure of this polarization signal has to do also with, say, with the magnetic field in our galaxy, the orientation of the magnetic field, the distribution of hot electrons, the dust, how the dust is aligned, which kind of grains, and so on, right? And this allowed Planck had all these various frequencies of observation, so this allowed Planck to fit the various frequency dependencies of the various signals, and they were known to some extent, but not so well. In polarization, they were not known at all, right? So we had no clue. We were just saying, okay, so if they are like that in temperature, then they should be similar in polarization. That's as good as we could get, right? Okay, so now I'm going to talk to you about what I actually work on. So among the various things that we could observe with Planck, we could observe extragalactic objects, and in particular, we could observe galaxy clusters. Galaxy clusters are the biggest gravitationally bound objects in our universe, and they have been studied since a long while ago to even infer properties of cosmological properties. For example, one of the first inference of the fact that the matter density is low, is not the critical density, is not the whole density in the universe, came from cluster number counts. Okay, so however, recently we had a new way of studying clusters. And this is through the so-called Sunyaev-Zeldovich effect. So what happens? So if you have there a cluster and behind you have the cosmic microwave background radiation, the cluster actually contains lots of free electrons heated at very high temperature, about 10 to the 7 Kelvin. So you have this 3 Kelvin radiation that passes through a 10 to the 7 Kelvin plasma. Occasionally, some photons, some CMB photons, interact with the electrons, and they get a very good kick through inverse Compton scattering. So some of those photons get promoted in frequency, okay? And so Specifically, what you notice is that in that direction, you have a distortion of the light of the cosmic microwave background. And the distortion has a very precise shape, this shape over here. So you can predict it very well. And I'm going to show you the movie. So this is a cluster. If you look at it only one frequency, you can't say it's a cluster. It could be just a blue blob of the CMB, right? But then I will show you that if you look at it, if I can manage to do it here, at the various frequency, you clearly show that it has a minimum, a null, and a maximum. And so these characteristics made it possible to detect clusters through this effect. The nice aspect of this effect is that it's redshift independent. So if you have a cluster very, very distant from you that went through this process, well, you see this distortion no matter where the cluster is. Well, normally, if you just look at galaxies or at the X-ray radiation, the further away the cluster is, the harder it is to detect it, right? Because it becomes dimmer and dimmer. So this was a very promising method, but it's also a very new method to detecting objects. The first SZ detection of cluster occurred in 2009, okay? And this is the map of Planck-detected clusters. So there are 1,600, about 2,000 candidates of them. And maybe you're not so familiar with the topic, but so X-ray clusters, which have dominated the science of the last 20 years, the ROSAT satellite has a comparable number of clusters detected on the sky from ROSAT, right? So we went from zero SZ detected cluster in 2009 to like a 2000 with Planck. And these are all sky, right? This shows what I told you before. The green points are X-ray selected cluster. You see as you go farther and farther, the selection function becomes steeper and steeper. You only get supermassive objects that don't exist very distant from you. And instead, this is the Planck selection function. The black dots are the Planck selection function. It flattens out, so you can actually also detect distant clusters, right? So this is what we gained in terms of very massive clusters and relatively more distant with Planck. And this shows the complementarity from, you can do the same exercise from the ground. In fact, there are experiments that do it, the Atacama Cosmology Telescope and the South Pole Telescope here in green and red. And this shows you the complementarity between the Planck satellite results, these black dots, which primarily, they cover the whole sky, but they tend to get the big guys because 5 arc minutes resolution for clusters is not a very high resolution. And the ground-based experiments that look at smaller area of the sky, but they have a higher resolution, so they also detect smaller clusters. And again, going with even higher redshift. So this is a new kind of branch for cosmology. And how can you use those? Well, what has been done in the past is precisely what your colleague was asking the other before, is to determine the amplitude of these anisotropies, not with the CMB power spectrum, but actually with a matter power spectrum determination. So looking at the amplitude of anisotropy in the matter. So if you look at the present time, the yellow dots represent spikes in the density distribution. The more you have of those spikes, the larger are the anisotropies on the scales of the spike. So this amplitude goes in jargon under the name of sigma 8. And also, if you look how that varies in time, this can tell you which type of universe you live in. So that can give you some information about the cosmology. So Planck was able to do that. And what they found is that if we were looking at the Planck SZ cluster, we were inferring a value of sigma 8 that is lower than what we would infer if we looked at the amplitude of the power spectrum. So there is a discrepancy within the same Planck results. If you look at the data that you extract regarding galaxy clusters, and if you look at the whole power spectrum of the CMB. So this is pretty intriguing. So people are working on systematics that may impact these results. But of course, there is also the possibility that that there is some physics in there. For example, one possibility is that you have the effect of a non-zero neutrino mass that is sufficiently big to explain this discrepancy. And I will not tell you how this is the case, but essentially these two measurements, the CMB looks at very large distances from us, and this blue cluster measurement measure what happens close to us. In between, there is the whole history of structure formation, which can be affected by the type of dark matter you have, right? So if your hypothesis regarding the dark matter is incorrect, and here it was supposed that it was old cold dark matter, essentially, then you may get these discrepancies. So people are working on it. How am I doing in time? Okay, so other cool things you can do with those maps, instead of just detecting individual clusters, you can do component separation and reconstruct the actual map of the Sunyaev-Zeldovich signal. Okay, and so this has been done. From these maps, you can compute the matter power spectrum and again evaluate this amplitude, and this turned to be in agreement with what was determined from cluster number counts, and in disagreement with what has been measured with a cosmic microwave background spectrum. So it kind of all cluster measurements, all matter power spectrum measurements agree, and the CMB on the other side disagree. So this is pretty interesting, right? Okay. So yet we haven't arrived to what I worked on. So what I worked on was what is called the kinetic Sunyaev-Zeldovich effect. So aside from this effect that I showed you before, which is the thermal effect, if the cluster itself as a whole is moving toward you or away from you, there is this Doppler signature imprinted on the light that you get from this cluster. So if you measure it, you can essentially measure how fast the clusters are moving with respect to you, so their peculiar velocity. Okay, this is a very subtle signal to detect. I'm not gonna tell you how this is done, but it became of great interest a while ago because there were some guys that had used X-ray clusters as tracers around us in a sphere of about 300 megaparsec around us. And they computed, using the WMAP map, they computed how all those clusters were moving collectively with respect to us. Not one by one, because that's a very difficult measurement, but they made an analysis of how the whole set of clusters was moving, and they were claiming that essentially there was a whole sphere around us that was moving with respect to the cosmic microwave background at very high velocities. This was in contrast with the theories of structure formation that we believe in. So it was kind of pointing out to some kind of very weird feature that would happen on very large scale. And so several people kind of looked into this, and there was a debate that went on and on for several years. And among the Planck team, we also did the analysis in actually more than one way. And we concluded essentially that the error bars were too big to come to the conclusion that this Kashlinsky and collaborator had derived, that we think that they overestimated underestimated their error bars. They think that we overestimated our error bars, but you know, the official answer from our side is that there is not such an effect. So at the moment, our understanding of the leading model still stands. Another thing that one can do by studying these velocities is actually looking at the pairwise velocities. So if two clusters are actually moving toward each other, and you expect this to be the case if they are sufficiently close, right? They're just gravitationally bound. This measure was predicted, you know, that the theory was developed by Peebles in the 1980s or something, but it was actually never done with cluster. There was a first detection of such signal with the ACT experiment a few years ago, 2012 or something like that. And then some part of the collaboration did an analysis with the Planck results, and they found it at about 3 sigma. It's not very significant, but it is there. Lastly, since you bear with me up until the last talk, I'm going to tell you something that should appear on the archive thing next week, which is a work that primarily my student, Sievashi Assini, and myself in secondary have done. So what he did is to actually compute the precise values for the spectral distortions of the cosmic microwave background radiation if you are in a moving frame with respect to the cosmic microwave background. And as I told you at the one of the first slides I showed you had the CMB at 2.7 Kelvin and then the dipole moment, and I told you this gets interpreted as our motion with respect to the CMB rest frame. But in fact, you could imagine that there is some kind of intrinsic anisotropy in the CMB. It could be zero, but there are some theories according to which it could be different from zero. So what Sievashi have done is that he actually computed, so the two signals, you may say, well, if we move with respect to the CMB, we still see a differential black body spectrum in the various frequencies, and this is what we have been using up to now to determine this our velocity with the CMB rest frame. But if you had a very, very accurate measurement, as we are going to have, because there is this PIXI experiment that is being resubmitted to NASA that wants to do what FIRAS did, but better, so measure the power spectrum, the frequency spectrum very precisely, then you are going to be able to detect these other distortions that appear in the case we are moving with the CMB rest frame, but wouldn't appear if there is an intrinsic dipole in the CMB. And the paper deals with how you can actually disentangle these two signals. So let's see if people believe us. So I said a lot of things. I tried to tell you a little bit the exciting story regarding the cosmic microwave background radiation, how it developed, and the big steps it made. The result is that most of the primary cosmological parameters are now determined with a sub-percent or few percent precision. The latest result from Planck focused on polarization measurement, and that allowed to put better results out on the reionization history primarily, and also on aspects like gravitational waves and therefore early universe studies. So we corrected some statement made regarding when reionization occurred. There are the best upper limits on primordial gravitational waves. And then I presented the results from what can be done with the Sunyaev-Zeldovich clusters, showing that there is a little bit of a discrepancy between what we determine from Sunyaev-Zeldovich cluster as amplitude of the overall fluctuations and what we determine from the CMB power spectrum itself. I tried to tell you with the possibilities of the kinetic Sunyaev-Zeldovich effect, which is actually just starting to be investigated. And then I threw a window on the future on how we can actually measure distortions of the CMB to derive information regarding our motion with respect to the CMB, as well as the intrinsic CMB anisotropies.
Because
So the result, these Sunev-Zeldovich maps that I showed, they come out from this component separation strategy. And so the actual CMB map that you measure, that then on which you do science, has those subtracted. You have a component separation procedure that fits for the CMB anisotropies as well as the various foregrounds, the galactic foregrounds, the extragalactic ones, and including the Sunev-Zeldovich. And of course, within Planck, being like, I don't know, 2,200 people, 400, but I don't know how many in the collaboration, you actually had different groups with different methodologies to make this work. So then you would compare results and... Well, so of course the selection function is different because the SZ effect. So they both trace the distribution of gas in the cluster. So not the baryons that are in galaxies, but the diffuse gas. But the Sunev-Zeldovich effect is sensitive to the product of the density times the temperature of the cluster, and the X-ray clusters instead are sensitive to the density times the temperature to the density squared and temperature to the 1/2. So if you look at clusters, they look differently. I should switch talk. I should take out my lecture from today. So they look the same clusters. If you look it into the two wavebands, is actually different. So there will be some selection effect, different selection effect. And of course, there is the fact that X-ray, in order to detect a cluster in X-rays, if you put it further and further away, you are not seeing it any longer. But yes, there is some difference. Although they both map the gas, both measure. So for I don't know about all the other experiments, but for Planck, I think a very good fraction. So maybe we can look at here. So I don't want to quote numbers that are wrong, but I would say a very good fraction. No, it's actually here. So these are the Planck clusters with redshift, the dots. So the ones with redshift could be either because they are confirmed in the optical or because they are confirmed with the X-rays. The dotted ones are reflex clusters. So say these ones have been detected by both experiments, but this one has not been detected by the X-ray measurement. And all these are in the area, in the reflex area, but they have not been detected by it. So I don't know, by eye, like it depends also at up to what redshift you want to look at. The at low redshift, actually the interesting part, if you look at here, at low redshift, there are a lot of X-ray clusters that are not detected in the density. But you know why they're not detected? Because they are too broad. And so in SZ experiments, they are more easily confused with the structure of the CMB that has a size of about 1 degree. OK.
Yeah, but rather than a nice little point, it's something more like a pattern of CMB.
Yes, so if they are bigger. Yeah, so they are bigger on the sky. So they.
So I have two questions.
Okay.
One of them is that, so like in 15 minutes, last 15 minutes of the talk was the deviation from measuring primordial time in terms of the universe. So my question is that, like regarding the limits and the error bars on primordial parameters, like FNL or tensor to a scalar ratio, is there any room for non-zero detection of these parameters in this in the future CMB experiments?
Well, so the primordial signal, it would be nice to have to have an actual prediction. So the difficulty with the B modes is that as far, I'm not an early universe person, but as far as I know, there are inflationary theories that are compatible with the current observations that we have, but have predictions on B modes at various levels, you know, from 10 to the minus 6 to 0.1 as the upper limits. So the difficulty there is that there is no actual prediction. So the only thing we can do is to say, okay, more or less the foregrounds, we know now that they have this intensity, how well can we subtract those, and what's gonna be our upper limit on B? This is what people that are planning future experiments tend to do. I take a very pragmatic approach. So now DOE is working, right? So there is a very big working group that is trying to make predictions for a few, like a super Planck kind of experiment, focused on B mode detections, essentially. This is one effort. The other effort is this other PIXI experiment that has just recently been reproposed, that is more dedicated toward distortions. So it's an old sky, but lower resolution experiment, like 1 degree or so, with very various frequency coverage so that you can subtract the foregrounds well, and then it's gonna look at the distortion. So this has been reproposed to NASA. It's a less expensive experiment. Maybe it will go through. Of course, if the detection of gravitational waves actually really occurred, that would have been an incredible boost, right? But it didn't work out very well, so.
Keep it nice and short, because otherwise...
Yeah, you have to go.
Okay, so the other question is that, so you talked about this entanglement between, for the dipole asymmetry, using some Gaussian models on the galaxy model system. So my question is that, like, do we ever, can we ever possibly put constraints on this possible primordial dipole asymmetry on the sky? Like, either it's from a primordial gauge field or it's from like a mode entering the horizon sometimes.
Well, so this would be the prediction on the intrinsic dipole for standard adiabatic perturbation that are the one we currently believe in. The prediction is that the intrinsic dipole is zero. So these kind of studies would actually be preferentially targeted to constrain other types of model. We haven't carried out the model-specific results for the moment. So the plots that you show simply assume an intrinsic dipole of about 10 to the minus 5, so same amplitude as the other perturbation, and we show that there should be an effect that is visible. But so we haven't done anything model specific. The idea would be precisely then to become model specific once the referee accept the first paper.